One night when Dean ate supper at my house, he already had the parking lot job in New York, he leaned over my shoulders as I typed rapidly away and said, "Come on, man, those girls won't wait. Make it fast." As we rode in the bus in the weird phosphorescent void of the Lincoln Tunnel, we leaned on each other with fingers waving and yelled and talked excitedly. And I was beginning to get the bug like Dean. He was simply a youth tremendously excited with life. And though he was a con man, he was only conning because he wanted so much to live and to get people involved with him who would otherwise pay no attention to him. We went up to his parking lot where he had a few things to do, change his clothes in the shack and back, and spruce up a bit in front of a cracked mirror and so on. And then we took off. And that was the night Dean met Carlo Marx. A tremendous thing happened when Dean met Carlo. Two keen minds that they are, they took to each other at the drop of a hat. Two piercing eyes glanced into two piercing eyes. The holy con man with a shining mind and the sorrowful poetic con man with the dark mind that is Carlo Marx. From that moment on, I saw very little of Dean, and I was a little sorry too. Their energies met head on. I was a lout compared. I couldn't keep up with them. They rushed down the street together, digging everything in the early way they had, which later became so much sadder and perceptive and blank. But then they danced down the street like dingle dodies, and I shambled after as I've been doing all my life with people who've been I've been interested in, because the only ones for me are the mad ones, the ones who are mad to live, mad to talk, mad to be saved, and desirous of everything at the same time. The ones who never yawn or say a commonplace thing, but burn, burn, burn like fabulous yellow Roman candles, exploding like spiders across the stars. And in the middle, you see the blue center light go, ha! And everybody goes, aw. A western kinsman of the sun, Dean. Although my aunt warned me he'd get me into trouble, I could hear a new call, see a new horizon, and believe it at my young age. And a little bit of trouble, or even Dean's eventual rejection of me as he would put me down later, what did it matter? I was a young writer, and I wanted to take off. And I did. Dawn was just beginning to break over Lake Michigan as I turned onto Lakeshore Drive. The intersection of Lakeshore Drive and Jackson is the beginning of the great route, the Mother Road, Route 66. A short stretch of Jackson runs from Lakeshore to Michigan Avenue. Then it's north on Michigan, a block to Adams. I turned left on Adams and began to head west. Part of Old 66 from Chicago to Joliet is now I-55. But south of Joliet, at a town called Gardner, the authentic old road begins to run parallel to 55. I had it all to myself that morning. I put back the seat, rolled through the great Illinois prairie with its fields of corn and crops on either side of me, lit full by the morning sun. I felt a part of the land driving so close to it, not isolated from it as those were on the interstate with its fences keeping everything at bay. I deeply inhaled the fresh air flowing in from the open windows as the sun warmed my arm resting on top of the door sill. As I looked at the runway and pavement in front of me, I began to feel the same way I felt driving through the San Joaquin Valley a few months before. Wonderfully content, joyous, free.